Everyone, so my name is Arunim Ray, and I was a PhD student with HADI during 2014 to 2017, and now I am a research engineer with ArcelorMittal R&D in Belgium, and I am grateful to you, Adriel, Dominic, and Steve, and HADI also, to give me this opportunity to chair this session. So now I will introduce our first speaker, Professor Shibrat Singh from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. And he will give us a talk on phase transformation of high strength steels. So Professor Singh, the floor is completely yours.
It has been 26 years and 7 weeks since I first met HADI in room 601. Of the old metallurgy and material science department on new museum site. And since you knew that I was coming from India, the very first thing that he told me, don't call me sir. But today I can officially disobey him and call him sir. Thank you, sir, Hari Vaidheshya, for introducing me to the wonderful world of phase transformations in steels. Whatever little I have learned on this subject is because of your training. So I'm grateful to you for everything that you have done. So with that, we will begin my talk on transformations in these steels. The phase transformations are very important because they govern the course of evolution of microstructure during thermomechanical processing. And it is the microstructure which in turn determines the mechanical properties of the material or its deformation behavior and therefore their performance during service. In steels especially, transformations can be studied using dielectrometry. It is a very powerful technique to determine the transformations, and they can detect, or it can detect transformations as they happen. So we have been studying this and trying to develop different techniques. So this is a typical dielectrometry curve. If you cool a material from high temperature austenite phase, so this is the kind of behavior we get. Usually it is used to detect the transformation start and finish temperatures, but during the transformation we can quantify and get much more detailed information about the transformation. So this is a method that we have developed. If it is assumed that the volume change or the length change is isotropic because of the transformation, then the length change is a function of the fraction of the phases and their lattice parameters. The lattice parameter in turn depends on the temperature and the composition of the phase. Obviously, at all points, we must have mass balance. So what we did is we solved these equations iteratively until we get a very good match between the experimental dilatation curve and the calculated dilatation curve. And from there, we can extract informations like fraction of the phases. And with certain assumptions, we can also determine the composition of at least one of the phases and the thermal expansion coefficients. So we have done this for all transformations that we see, for example, during austenite formation from pearlite or during cooling. So the first transformation that I would discuss is martensite. When austenite is cooled rapidly enough, it will transform into martensite. And that is easy because in this case, the parent phase and the product phases both have the same composition. So therefore, there is one less variable to deal with. So we did these experiments on two sets of steel and cooled at very rapid rate to get martensite. And then use this set of equations to work out the fraction of the phases. And when we fitted, we found out that usually the lattice parameters of martensite are given as a function of carbon content only. And we found out that if the effect of substitutional alloying elements is not included, then the fit is not very good. But if we include the effect of all the substitutional alloying elements, that is very good fit between the experimental and the calculated dilatation curves. And once we did that, we can then work out the fraction of the phases as a function of transformation temperature. And here what we see is the fractions calculated for two steels using the present approach and the one using lever rule. So we get a good match. We then compared these results with a thermal transformation kinetics proposed first by Kostinen and Marburger, followed by many similar equations. And we found out that most of the equations give a very good match between the experimental and the calculated transformation kinetics curves in the initial part of transformation. But towards the late stage of transformation, there is a bit of mismatch. But the equations that were proposed later on by Lee and Tyne or Bowman, they give a better representation of the experimental transformation behavior. We also determined the C by A ratio using the dielectrometric data, and we found out that in our steels it was close to 1.006, which matches very closely with the C by A ratio that we measured from X-ray and the C by A ratio that we calculated from the revised C by A ratio proposed by Liu et al. In 2017. So we know, we are confident about this method that it works and it gives useful results. So moving on, we extended same analysis to bainite transformation during continuous cooling, starting with a steel containing 0.28% carbon. We did the same and we fitted the data assuming that bainite or bainitic ferrite is body centered cubic and its carbon content is negligibly small. We did not get very good fit between the experimental and the calculated curve. And also it gave very ridiculous results, like very ridiculous solubility of carbon in austenite. So we know that that is not the correct assumption about crystal structure of bainite. When we assume the crystal structure to be BCC and carbon content, we let the program determine the carbon content. We found out that the fit improves, but the best fit was obtained when it was assumed that bainitic ferrite has body-centered tetragonal crystal structure, and we worked out the carbon content to be about 0.179. Carbon content of bainitic ferrite was worked out to be about 0.18, which is close to the carbon content of the original austenite, which were undergoing transformation, and it matches with the carbon content of bainitic ferrite calculated from the X-ray diffraction data. So conclusion, these results include lead to the conclusion that crystal structure of bainitic ferrite could be body-centered tetragonal, because that gives the best match between the observed dilatation curve and the calculated ones. It contains higher carbon than is usually believed, and therefore the transformation mechanism could be displacive. But then if you are studying bainite and martensite transformation, direct experimental validation against the new method that we proposed is difficult, because it is very difficult to distinguish bainite from martensite. So we tested this method against ferrite transformation, where we austenitized the sample and transformed in intercritical region. So this is the response of the dielectrometer during ferrite transformation. And after transforming to ferrite in the intercritical region, rest of the austenite would transform to martensite at a lower temperature. We can easily estimate the fraction of ferrite from optical microscopy, and the results show that the amount of ferrite estimated or measured from optical microstructure matches very closely with the one estimated from analysis of the dilatation curve. So we are confident about the method that we are using. In addition, we are able to estimate the carbon content of austenite that remains untransformed at the intercritical temperature. And from there, if we calculate the MS temperature, that MS temperature matches very closely with the MS or experimental MS temperature. So the method is a robust one and can be used, and we have been using it extensively. Moving on to isothermal transformation of bainite and analysis, what I will show you, that analysis of this gives some interesting insight into the transformation. So we started with these two steels, austenitized it and austempered it directly in the Benai transformation region. In another set of experiment before austempering, we treated the material to obtain about 50% of ferrite in the intercritical region. So red dashed line represents the transformation where bainite is forming from an austenite, which has about double the original carbon content, which was about 0.28%, whereas the green line represents simple or direct austempering treatment where bainite is forming from austenite containing about 0.2% carbon. And these are the simple dilatometry curve which represents the transformation to bainite during austempering, or in this case, the dilatometer curve represents ferrite transformation during intercritical treatment, followed by formation of bainite during austempering treatment. And microstructure is obvious that in the case where we subject the material to intercritical treatment, there is about 50% ferrite. What is and we confirm the microstructure. In all the conditions, the samples contain a certain amount of retained austenite. But what is more interesting is in the samples that were directly austempered after austenitization, the carbon content of retained austenite followed the T0 line very closely, and the carbon content of bainitic ferrite was measured to be very small. Whereas when austempering was preceded by ferrite transformation in the intercritical region, we found out that the carbon content of retained austenite was larger than the calculated T0 curve, and carbon content of bainitic ferrite was much higher, and it followed a trend. It showed a trend which indicated that carbon content of bainitic ferrite increases slightly with decreasing transformation temperature. So these are two interesting sets of results which we obtained, and we are not the first ones to observe this. The similar results have been reported way back in 2000 and 2004, where austenite was shown to contain carbon shown to have a carbon concentration which was higher than the calculated T0 line. And there were explanations like it could be because of heterogeneous distribution of carbon in austenite. In all these results, there was no word about the carbon content of bainitic ferrite. But in more recent years, there are a lot of data which indicate that carbon content of bainitic ferrite away from segregations, away from locations where they segregate, is much higher than usually believed. And there is that, even though this is not explicitly mentioned in all these literature, but there is a small temperature dependence in the sense that at lower temperatures, the carbon content of bainitic ferrite is higher, and it is difficult to temper. It does not get tempered, or it does not relieve its excess, what is believed to be excess within quotes, excess carbon easily. So it continues to hold excess carbon even after long term tempering treatment. So the reason could be, the reason can be understood by considering this vein distortion model, according to which when supersaturated ferrite first forms as a result of shear transformation, it is completely tetragonal. But what happens afterwards depends on the transformation temperature vis-a-vis the carbon content of parent austenite from which ferrite forms. If the transformation temperature is above the so-called Zener ordering temperature, then the crystal structure is a body-centered cubic, because carbon atoms then randomize on all the lattice sites. Whereas if the transformation temperature is less than the Zener ordering temperature, then the crystal structure continues to remain body-centered tetragonal. And there are, after the original estimate of Zener, which is represented by the red line here, there were several improved versions which indicate how the ordering temperature would change with the carbon content of parent austenite, and our results are shown here. So on the top line, and our austenitic treatment was done at 440 degrees centigrade. So since crystal structure of bainitic ferrite could be body-centered tetragonal under when the transformation takes place below Zener ordering temperature, we should consider equilibrium between austenite and body center tetragonal ferrite rather than BCC ferrite and austenite. So this is what is traditionally done, and the crossover point is marked as the T0 composition. But if indeed Benetic ferrite is body center tetragonal, and as I will show you afterwards, that it could have a lower free energy than body centered cubic structure under certain conditions. So then we should be considering equilibrium between body centered tetragonal ferrite and austenite. And when we do that, we see that the point of tangency would change, and the T0 curve will also shift towards higher carbon concentration. This is exactly what was proposed by Harry and his co-workers based on DFT calculations, where he showed that body-centered cubic ferrite containing 1.38% carbon and having a C by A ratio of 1.07 would have lower Gibbs free energy than the body-centered cubic structure. And the energy difference is about 1,000 joules per mole, not 1,000 kilojoules per mole. And based on this, he recalculated the equilibrium between body-centered tetragonal ferrite and austenite and showed that when that happens, when the crystal structure changes from body-centered cubic to tetragonal, solubility of carbon in ferrite increases. And that is exactly what we are observing. So we went back and we recalculated this. So the reason we are seeing that the veritic ferrite contains less carbon when the transformation temperature is higher, because it is cubic. When the transformation temperature is lower, it is body centered tetragonal, and therefore it has higher carbon. Obviously, the thermodynamics of this has not yet been worked out. Therefore, we tried to back calculate the free energy difference between body centered cubic and body centered tetragonal form of ferrite from these data, and they are plotted here, and this is the original estimate of Harry and co-workers, whereas these are our estimates back calculated from observed shift in T0 curve. These data remain to be validated. Whenever we have means, we can see what is the difference in the free energy between cubic and tetragonal forms of BCT ferrite. So, to summarize this part of the curve, it is analysis of dilatation data can help understand evolution of microstructures, and results indicate that Benetic ferrite, even though I have written the term supersaturated, it contains higher carbon than dictated by equilibrium between cubic ferrite and austenite. Why is it important? This is important when we want to do heat treatment for producing a typical multi-phase trip microstructure, where austempering is an essential step. During austempering, if one has to calculate the amount of benetic ferrite that forms and therefore the amount of retained austenite that would be left behind in the microstructure, we would need the phase boundaries. Our results indicate that the phase boundaries, both the T0 curve and the carbon content of benetic ferrite, shift to higher carbon concentration. Therefore, they have to be taken into account when we have to estimate the fraction of different phases. And that is important because, as we all know, carbon in ferrite causes immense increase in strength. If I remember correctly, 1.8% carbon in ferrite would increase the yield strength by 4.5 gigapascal. So if benetic ferrite indeed contains about 0.28% carbon, as our results show, then it will cause strengthening of ferrite. So we used this knowledge for designing quenching and partitioning treatment as well. And it is a very simple heat treatment that was proposed way back in early 2000 by Spear and his co-workers. So after austenitization, the steel is quenched to a quenching temperature where it transforms partially to martensite. And then it is given one step or two step partitioning treatment where excess carbon of martensite is released into austenite, thereby enriching austenite with carbon. So difference with trip-aided microstructure is, in the case of trip-aided steels, the carbon enrichment of austenite is on account of ferrite transformation in the intercritical region as well as during bainite transformation. Whereas in this case, in the QNP process, the carbon enrichment of austenite is on account of decarburization of martensite that forms during initial quenching. And of course, the material is finally quenched to room temperature. So depending on the extent of carbon enrichment of austenite during partitioning treatment, entire amount of austenite could be retained at room temperature or part of it could undergo martensite transformation. So these are pictured, or sometimes non-isothermal partitioning treatment is also recommended, where after initial quenching to the quenching temperature, there is no isothermal step, but the material is allowed to cool very slowly, like during coiling of hot rolling process. So during cooling, the material will cool very slowly and partitioning of carbon from supersaturated martensite to austenite would take place. So microstructural changes are simple. During initial quenching, first supersaturated martensite forms. And because these steels have lower carbon content, let's say about 0.28% carbon and therefore higher MS temperature, therefore some auto tempering could also take place. So some carbides could form as a result of auto tempering, and lots of dislocations are also generated as a result of martensitic transformation, and they would trap carbon. Finally, during final quenching to room temperature, austenite that gets enriched with carbon might transform to martensite or might not transform to martensite depending on its carbon content at the end of the partitioning treatment. So these are results from our own studies on some experimental steels containing about 0.25% carbon. And in the completely quenched sample, the samples that were quenched to room temperature, signal or carbides that formed as a result of auto temper clearly visible. So indeed, auto tempering takes place. Speer has proposed a very simple model to calculate the amount of retained austenite and the temperature at which the amount of retained austenite is maximized, known as the optimum quenching temperature. This simple model assumes that there are no competing reactions, the interface between martensite and austenite is stationary, and martensite loses its supersaturation completely. So if actual experimental results on our experimental steel are compared with the model calculations, then there is a big mismatch between the calculated curve and the actual curve, especially with reference to the optimum quenching temperature, which the model predicts to be 182 degrees centigrade, and the amount of retained austenite is predicted to be 19%, whereas in reality, the optimum temperature is about 260 degrees centigrade, and the amount of retained austenite is 12%. And similarly, the carbon content of retained austenite is also not predicted correctly by the simple model proposed by Speer. So there is a mismatch between calculated and the experimental curve is because during partitioning treatment, there is indeed bainite transformation. Carbide precipitation can take place. Carbon remains trapped at dislocations, and therefore this is not taken into account in the Speer model. We tried to take all of this into account, and experimental results, which are shown here, clearly show that during partitioning treatment at 400 degrees centigrade in our case, there is definite sign of bainite transformation. Also, more interestingly, after bainite transformation is over, there is a small volume contraction. And we believe that this volume contraction is because of transformation of transition carbide to more stable carbides. We do not have any direct evidence yet, but this is what we believe. So there is direct experimental evidence that during partitioning treatment, bainite transformation takes place. There are several other things might be going on. For example, recovery of dislocation will take place during partitioning. And when the dislocations would recover, the carbon atoms that were locked by the dislocations will also get released, and they will therefore be available for partitioning or for precipitation. So it is an extremely complex process, but we try to address some of them. Once again, we assume that when the partitioning treatment is above the Zener ordering temperature, carbon content of bainitic ferrite is low. When it is lower than the Zener ordering temperature, carbon content of bainitic ferrite was assumed to be 0.2. And taking that into account, we were able to produce a better match between the experimentally measured retained austenite content and the one predicted by the improved model. And obviously, if the quenching temperature is optimum, then the combination of mechanical properties is the best, and the presence of retained austenite is indicated when we start analyze strain hardening and how it changes with strain. Here, strain hardening over a fairly wide range of strain does not show much of a change because of the trip effect, whereas in the directly water quench sample, the strain hardening rate continues to decrease with increasing strain. So based on this, we had designed several heat treatments, and these heat treatments produce somewhat better results than the existing material. The best that we got is pointed out here. Even though we have done some work, but there are lots of issues that need to be addressed. Kinetics, it is difficult to predict, especially in the presence of martensite that forms before bainite forms. So that is an area that we are working on. Similarly, carbon content of bainitic ferrite, we need to understand it better. Carbon carbide formation or dissolution during partitioning, I think at least solubility limit or the solubility of transition carbides when it is in equilibrium with ferrite is not clearly understood, or I think not clearly modeled. So this is another area that need to be addressed. And of course, phase transformation during non-isothermal partitioning is an issue that we are working on. Going back to what can be done for analysis of dilatation curve. So if we produce martensite, let's say this is a medium carbon steel quench to produce martensite, and when we temper it at a given heating rate, let's say at 2 degrees centigrade, the dilatation curve clearly shows a change in curvature because of all the microstructural changes that take place during tempering. And when we do the same thing on an annealed material, there is no such indication, so because there is no tempering. So is it possible to quantify all the microstructural changes just from the observations of the dilatometry data? Can it be done? So this is what we will try to address in future. So obviously I have to thank, apart from Professor Sir Hari Vadishya, all my other students who have helped me do this work. Thank you. Thank you for your kind attention.
Arunim, can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
Or make a comment rather. So I think this is really good because both dilatometry and X-ray diffraction give you a broad picture. You know, they look at a large volume of material, whereas other techniques like the atom probe and so on, high resolution microscopy, they're actually looking at very, very small amounts of material, almost negligible amounts of material. So they will always give you some sort of biased information. But if you combine those techniques and the dilatometry and X-ray, then you can get really a good picture of what is going on throughout your sample.
Yeah, Harry, that is indeed useful. When you have to combine all the results that we have, we cannot look at these results in isolation. So for example, for the body center tetragonal ferrite, we had some results based on transmission electron microscopy, but that community is very rigid, I suppose, because we got certain results which indicated that it is body center tetragonal and it matches with simulated diffraction patterns. So we argued that these results can be taken as circumstantial evidence. But then that community said, no, this is not acceptable. It can happen because of variety of other reasons, but then it can happen because of ferrite being tetragonal as well.
Right.
So we have to see the results in totality, not just look at one form. Another issue is somebody pointed out that when martensite forms, there are a lot of residual stresses and that would affect the lattice parameters. But in our case, we are using tubular samples with a wall thickness of about 2 millimeter. I'm not sure how big an effect that would be, but we will try to address it at some point.
But I think you have demonstrated, you know, for example, by looking at the tempering.
Yeah.
An anneal sample. And so I don't have any problems with this, but I recommend, you know, dilatometry in addition to all the high resolution techniques.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you, Harry. So there is one question in chat I can see from Amir Shizadi. So yeah, I can read out the question also. So he is asking, so silicon was always an issue when modeling phase transformation or predicting MS temperature. So he compliments, yeah, great to see your modeling can take silicon in account. I wonder how many elements can be included in the transformation calculations in the same time.
So in our calculations, we are using the effect of alloying elements on the lattice parameters. So it is available for many alloying elements. The effect of aluminium on the lattice parameters of martensite was not available, and we worked out from our own dilatometry data. This is a result somehow I did not show because I did not have time. Let me see if it is there. I can. So if you see this, we worked out how we calculated the lattice parameter of austenite, ferrite, and how aluminium would affect the lattice parameter of martensite, assuming that C by A ratio is a function of carbon content only. That was an assumption. And then we calculated the effect of different alloying elements on the lattice parameters using Bain model and compared them with literature model, and then worked out the effect of aluminium on the lattice parameters. So you can see these are the. Oops.
Jim, can I clear my question, please? Thank you very much. I meant that, are you looking at the effect of these elements one by one or in accumulative?
Cumulative. I mean, in
okay.
In
thank you very much.
Yeah, cumulative effect.
That's all I want to. Thank you. Yes. Excellent talk. Thank you. Very clear. Very thank clear you. Talk. Thank I you. Enjoyed it.
Thank you, Amir. Thank you, Professor. So I don't see any more questions. So I have one of my own question. So typically the theoretical models deal with like predicting absolute values. So like, is there any, like in practice, we see like a scatter of the experimental results, like whether it is MS or whether it is other transformation temperature, we see always a certain amount of scatter, and depending on the heterogeneity in the material, the scatter may be low, the scatter may be high. So I was thinking like whether this kind of theoretical models can predict like which processing can give like a better prediction in an absolute value for the experimental method.
No, scatter can be on account of various aspects, like because of heterogeneity or homogeneity in the material, or because the way we make measurements,
yeah.
Right? Whereas calculations cannot take those into account. If calculations have to take that into account, we have to, the input has to have those information. So then it can predict a scatter. But for calculations, we give a definite carbon content or manganese or silicon content, right? And a given cooling rate. Whereas when we are doing experiments, there could be deviations from the nominal values. For example, cooling cannot be uniform across the cross section, or the way you detect the beginning of martensite transformation could vary.
Yeah.
So these are the issues that would give rise to scatter, apart from heterogeneity or heterogeneous distribution of carbon or other alloying elements.
From Fabio, so he is unmuted.
Thank the speaker for the interesting presentation and make just a remark. You said very correctly to put all the things together, not just one way or the other of the analysis. So it would be also good in my mind to try to systematize, to put a calf data together, because we still don't know how to deal with a CALFA, because you have presented correctly free energy differences and so on. So it would be very nice to work, at least to consider whether or not we should enter in the thermodynamic database file more phases or not. So this is just a question, is an observation. So it would be nice to input further information you are getting from the physical situation to the modeling situation.
I think Alfred always does that. They update their database as and when they are available. But this for body-centered tetragonal ferrite, I don't think we have enough data available to be included into the database. That is as far as my understanding goes.
Yes, it's also my understanding. But in general, please.
Yeah, but in general, they would include or they update their database and they release next versions as and when the data are available. They revise the database all the time.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.